Tonight, I want to talk about the works of the church, or more accurately, like I try to say, the church works. So the works that we're supposed to be doing as a group. We've talked in the past few Sundays about the church that Jesus built and what that looks like when it's fully organized. It has elders and deacons and members that are doing the work of the church. We keep saying this word work, so we want to define those things. And that's what we're going to try and do tonight. So what is the work that's given to the church? Well, in three simple words, these three concepts kind of cover the vast majority of what is given to us in the New Testament. And those three things are evangelism, benevolence, and edification. And so now that we've already considered how the church was organized, we can look at what it needs to be doing. What does the Lord intend for his church to do in the world? And the big question is, are we free to do anything that we deem suitable? Are we free to involve the church in anything that we feel like it should be involved in? Or does God tell us what we need to be involved in? And that's really the question we're going to try and answer tonight. So it's really the work of the local church here that I'm trying to talk about tonight. And so let's look at some of those things. I'm going to skip some of my notes here to hopefully cut down on the length, because I overdid it a little bit on this one. So so the worship, we've looked at worship in the past. That was last Sunday. The different things we do during the worship service. We give of our means. We call that taking up a collection nowadays. We sing songs. We pray. We listen to a lesson. We read scripture. There's five general things there. I don't believe that worship is limited necessarily to those five things, but those five things generally cover what is mentioned in the New Testament. So, with that in mind, let's look to the Bible, and let's first stress that the work of the church includes evangelism. Of course, the summer's theme for the morning lessons has been on evangelism, and so at least once a month, I try to have a lesson, a practical lesson on how we can apply that, or different methods that we might use to apply the message. And so this morning we had a good look at faith in Romans, and how we might, that is the message that we might tell other folks. But, and so the early churches were involved in evangelism. If we look at 1 Peter chapter 3, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15, Peter is making a very, very good argument, and it's talking about submitting to God's authority in chapter 2, doing what God wants us to do, and then he moves into, he says, all the way back in verse 8 of chapter 3, he says, finally, all of you have unity in mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for good. Do not repay evil for evil, or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, bless, for this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and sees good days, and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to the prayer, their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. So Peter's telling us, very directly, how it is that we need to live our life. We need to have a tender heart, brotherly love, unity in mind. We can only have unity when we believe the same thing. If one of us believes that, oh, well, I'm going to go do this, and you can come if you don't want to, or if you want to, that's not unity. Unity is believing the same thing. And so when we sanctify Christ, sanctify means set apart for a special use. When we set something apart, that thing is Christ, in our hearts as Lord, we'll always be in unity together. We will always have unity together when we believe the same thing. And how do we know what to believe? Well, he wrote it down for us. And so we need to take what he's written down for us and then be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that's in you. This is not like cross-examination defense. This is, I do believe in God, and I believe, here's why. It's a very simple, doesn't have to be 3-4 pages long, debate structure type response. It's just a very simple, I believe in God because of what he did through his son. And if you'd like to find out more, we can study that. That's what a defense is to somebody who asks us why that hope's in us. And so we need to do that with gentleness and reverence. We don't need to make sure there's, the steel inserts in the back of our Bible so we can, really give it to them, right? And so the early churches were involved in evangelism. Evangelism isn't necessarily, like I said this morning, it's not necessarily a singular person. I am an evangelist. I call myself an evangelist. The world doesn't really know what that term means, so I tell them I'm a minister. And so, but it's not just a person that we pay to spread the gospel. While we do have evidence in that in the scripture, that's not what evangelism is. It's the actual telling of other people what the gospel is. It's not even necessarily handing out Bibles like we did on July 4th when we were handing out Bibles. That's part of it. But the message, getting the message out, is what evangelism is. It's having an answer for the hope that's within us. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 20 there says, therefore, 2 Corinthians 5:20 says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. That's the gospel message, to be reconciled to God. But first you have to realize that there's a need to be reconciled. Now, some of us take the big picture and we look out the door and we see the world falling apart and say, well, I think I want something different. And so for some people, it's easy. But some people who are living a great life, they have a house, big house, 2 cars, a wife, 2.5 children, white picket fence, just like all Americans, they don't see the need. And so we have to be ready for the to tell them about the hope that's within us, and that necessarily means telling them the truth about their situation. It's not making a judgment against them, it's telling the truth. So that's part of what evangelism is. So the early churches were involved in evangelism, and that's really consistent with what Jesus expected of us. His last words on earth that we have recorded in Matthew, of course, is the Great Commission. Matthew 28, starting in verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So Jesus, before he left, expected us to go out and tell other people. Now, of course, he's telling the 11 here in this case, but what does making a disciple mean? What is a disciple? A disciple is a follower, right? It's not just somebody who studies a little bit on weekends. It's somebody who devotes their whole life to following. Now, if he said go out and make disciples, those disciples are supposed to make more disciples. And so this command is then for us also. So the second point I'd like to make is that his people were supposed to proclaim the praises of God. So back in 1 Peter, where we were just a few seconds ago, in chapter 2, starting in verse 8, he's talking about the living stone and a holy people. Now, when he said holy people, they would have understood, oh, that's me, I'm a Jew, I'm holy, right? God chose me, he set me apart. But he says in verse 7, so honor is for you who believe. It's not based off of what your pedigree is or what your genealogy is. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected, that's Jesus, has become the cornerstone, and the stone of stumbling, a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. He's back to using the same terminology, talking about Jewish people, but he's talking about those people who believe now. A holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. So we're supposed to be proclaiming that. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. That was contradictory to what he just said. He said you were a holy nation. You're a nation. Well, yeah, we're Jews, right? Well, no. He says, once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. He's contrasting that with, it takes belief now, and not just belief. He said you have to obey. And so you have to obey by telling other people about that belief. That's what evangelism is. And so we're going to look at Ephesians 4:11 in a little bit. But let's do Acts chapter 4 next as we talk about benevolence. And benevolence is just the desire to do good to others. And that's what the word means in general. When we're talking about it in the New Testament, though, it means providing for the needy saints. And let me just say this again. It always means, in every instance in the New Testament, there's not an example of anything else always helping the needy saints. And so this is an important point to make, because you'll see as we get a little further, the early church cared for its members. And we can see this in Acts chapter 4. This is not very long after the church had even been formed. Acts chapter 2, 3,000 are saved. Acts chapter 4 talks about providing for its own widows. So let's look in verse 32, Acts chapter 4, verse 32, and see who it was he was talking to. It's chapter 4, verse 32. It says, "Now the full number of those who believed," so we know this is a group of believers, "were of one heart and one soul. And no one said to any of the things that belonged to them was his own, but they all had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as there were owners of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what is sold and laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need." So who were we talking about? Who was the need given to? Or who did the giving of the need? Well, the need was given to those members who needed it. It says, "in the congregation who believed," in verse 32. So it's the congregation who's giving to the need. What was the need? Well, there wasn't a need because they were taking care of them. That's the whole point. But verse 35 says, who is supposed to answer for the need? And what is that answer? They were supposed to be distributed to is each had need. So if there is a need in a church, specifically for food and shelter and things like this, then the church, other members of the church would help them, those members who were in belief together. And so we can see the church at Antioch a little bit later in Acts chapter 11. They were giving towards the needs of the brothers that were in Judea, because there was a famine that was coming. They were having a hard time. They were also being persecuted. So that's the church at Antioch. Then we can see the churches in Macedonia and Achaia in Acts chapter... Romans chapter 15. The churches in Macedonia and Achaia are taking care of the brothers in Jerusalem. So the organization and the worship of the church accommodated that benevolence. When they came together, they had an opportunity to help each other. Deacons were appointed. This is why deacons were first appointed by the apostles in the church. They were to serve the congregation. They were to take care of the benevolence. What was happening, and we specifically have a record of that in Acts chapter 6, when the Grecian widows were complaining that they were being overlooked, and the apostles said, well, let's just read it. Acts chapter 6 and verse 1 through 6 there. "Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists rose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. And the 12 summoned the full number of disciples and said, 'It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty.'" Let me just stop there. So he says it's not right that we should give up the preaching of the word of God to serve tables. He says their primary duty, the primary duty of any Christian, not just the apostles, was to preach the word of God. And if somebody needs a physical need taken care of, we need to take care of that, yes. But we shouldn't put that ahead of preaching the word. And so the collection for needy saints was also made a part of the weekly assembly. When Paul talks about it in 1 Corinthians 16, he says, take up a collection every week so that there won't be any need when he arrives. There won't be a sudden urge to collect money. And so, but there were also limitations on that benevolence. Paul's instructions to Timothy that widows with believing family members were not supposed to be supported. The family members were supposed to support them. Their own families should support them so that the church would not be burdened, is what he says. So examples of benevolence then are limited to needy saints. It's in every case, like I said earlier, in every case of church benevolence, and every time we see it in the New Testament, where money is taken from the money bag, the one Judas had, from the church treasury, the recipients were believers in need. So it's not to say that individual Christians aren't expected to be good Samaritans. That's not what I'm saying at all. And help those people in the world as they have the opportunity. But it really implies that the church, the local church, was not intended to be a social agency to cure the various illnesses in the society at large in the world. The church doesn't have the resources or the organization to take care of every need in the world. And so the primary work of the church was never benevolence, like we talked about Acts chapter 6. It's not right that we should give up preaching so that we could feed even our own members. So, but let's move on to the third point here. Edification, or preparing the saints for service. So, like we've talked about, and it's kind of implied by the organization of the church when we looked at elders and deacons and different things, edification is one of the primary, if not the most primary, goal of the local church. It's supposed to be teaching each other, preparing each other for evangelism, for taking care of needs like benevolence. So, as we carry out our responsibilities, the church will be built up, and the activities of our worship are designed to edify, to teach each other. Singing, we're exhorting each other, we're encouraging each other, we're admonishing each other, as well as praising God. And preaching and teaching generally edifies the church. It's explicitly mentioned in the scriptures, like I was talking about in Ephesians 4:11. He gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers. So evangelists, shepherds is the same as the elder, and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. That's how we gain unity, is through the Word of God. And it has to be the same as everybody else to be called unity. That's what unity is. And so, each person in the church does their part. As they do their part, the end result will be the growth of the body, the church, the edifying itself in love. That's right after this in Ephesians chapter 4, and verse 15. So when we look at how the church is organized and what we do, what it is called to do in worship, and the purpose of the gifts that Christ gave his church, I really think that it's really fair to say that edification is one of the most important spiritual developments of its members, learning to edify one another. So to kind of summarize, we've looked at the primary work of the church being evangelism, that's proclaiming the gospel, benevolence, that's providing for the needy saints, and edification, that's preparing the saints for service. And if you have need of putting any of these into practice, or you have any other need that needs to be taken care of this evening, please let somebody know. And let's all stand and sing the closing song.